From the News Channel 5 Network, this is Inside Politics.
Hello, everyone. I'm News Channel 5's political analyst, Pat Nolan. Welcome to Inside Politics. It's our great pleasure to have as our guest today on Inside Politics, Tennessee Senior United States Senator Lamar Alexander. Senator Alexander, thank you for joining us again today.
Thank you,
Pat. Congratulations on winning your primary and the Republican nomination for perhaps another 6 years in the Senate.
Thank you.
In winning the nomination in August, you received slightly less than 50% of the total vote. Is that a concern for you as you go into the general election?
No, not really. I mean, it was the biggest Senate primary we've ever had. We had seven candidates. I won by about the same margin that I won in 2002 when I won the Republican primary.
In terms of percentages?
About 60,000 votes, about 9%. That's a pretty good win in any book. Plus, I ran no negative ad. I never mentioned my opponent's name, and I think that'll serve me well in the general election.
It's not going to happen all the way to November?
Nope. Now we've got a different ball game.
Okay.
We've got some real differences.
Now, there are some observers who say one of the reasons you came in without a full majority is because there's some continuing estrangement with the conservative Tea Party voters in the GOP. Even your major primary opponent, Joe Carr, when he met with you, said when you asked for advice, he told you to reach out to those particular voters. Is he right about that, and what are you doing to reach out to the conservative
voters? Well, he is right about it, and I am doing that. Of course, I've done that the last several years, and he and others got more of their votes than I did in some cases. But I'm reaching out. They're supporting me. They're supporting me because they know that my opponent's one more vote for Barack Obama's agenda, and that I'm one more vote for a new Republican majority in the United States Senate. And in a general election, I think Republican and conservative voters in Tennessee understand that difference.
Now, as your outreach to conservative voters particularly tatered here in the Nashville, Middle Tennessee area, you lost almost all those counties here, which I don't remember you ever doing before in a primary. So you need some outreach, particularly in those areas?
That's true. But we've grown here. I mean, when I was elected governor, we had 250,000 votes in the Republican primary, and not many here. Now we had 660,000 votes and a lot more here. So we have lots of Democrats and independents, people who used to be voting in our primary. That's good. So I'm glad to have them there. I'm going to try to get their votes in November.
You keep getting this criticism that you're not conservative enough. Is that fair?
Well, you know, it's like saying I'm a better Christian than you are in Sunday school. You know, I don't say that about other people. I've been endorsed by the NRA. I've been endorsed by National Right to Life. I have a 100% voting record with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and the National Federation of Independence Businessmen. But compared to my opponent, who's one more vote for Barack Obama, I'm a real conservative.
I think I'm going to hear you say that a lot today.
I think you are, and he will.
Now, you know, isn't this really all coming down as far as people being unhappy with you on the right because you voted in favor of the immigration reform bill that went through the Senate?
I doubt that's true. I mean, I was visited by the chairman of the American Conservative Union who urged me to vote for the immigration bill. I was visited by Grover Norquist, who's head of Americans for Tax Reform, who urged me to vote for the immigration bill. The Tennessee Farm Bureau urged me to vote for the immigration bill, and I think I did the right thing.
But the bill died in the House. No second thoughts or regrets about voting for it.
I do. We have to fix that problem. I voted for border security and to create a legal system and to end perpetual amnesty. And sooner or later, we're going to have to find a way to do that.
Now, you mentioned a lot about your opponent, Gordon Ball, being another vote for Barack Obama. During the primary, Joe Carr accused you of being a vote for Barack Obama. He used at least one survey that said 62% of the time. How do you defend yourself?
The same article said I voted with the majority of Republican senators 82% of the time. Plus, I'm not running against Joe Carr. I didn't mention his name in the primary. A primary is a family discussion. This is a difference of opinion. I mean, we have a chance to have a new Republican majority. I want to be part of it, move the country in a more conservative direction, and people who didn't support me in the primary, I think, want that too.
Now, the early polls from the general election, I see one from Rasmussen, another from New York Times, both have about the same numbers. You're at 42%. Mr. Ball's at 32%. Again, below 47 to 32. Again, below 50%. Again, not a concern necessarily?
Well, no, that's where most people are. That most Republican incumbents are in that neighborhood, 47, 45, 50, 52. At this point, there are a lot of undecided people. But if you take the undecided out and ask them, do you want a Republican senator or a Democratic senator? You want one more vote for Obama, or do you want to try going in a different direction? I think Tennesseans are going to go my way.
Now, Gordon Ball's from East Tennessee. Republicans, that's usually their traditional base. Are you going to have to do some things over in East Tennessee to defend yourself over there?
Of course I am. I work. I mean, that's where I live too. And I was at Vol Market 3 with Mayor Tim Burchett of Knoxville last week. We had a good time, and I met with all the local officials in Blount County, and I'll be back there next week.
Now, one of the ways I suspect you'll defend yourself over in there is that 6 years ago, Gordon Ball thought you were a pretty good senator. He was on a list of Democrats who endorsed you. Are you going to remind him and the voters about
that? Well, I don't know if I need to do that. He did endorse me 6 years ago, and I don't know what changed his mind.
Now, when you're running on the one hand to get the right to like you come back, to get Democrats and independents to come in, doesn't that kind of give you a lot of push-pull? How do you run in both directions at the same time?
I just try to say what I'm for. I mean, I think Tennesseans know me pretty well, for better or worse, and they know I like to solve problems. And I want to get up there and I want to change the Obama health agenda, the Obama education agenda, the Obama labor agenda, and I want to retire Harry Reid. And I think there are lots of independents and some Democrats who'd be glad to go in that different direction and glad to have me up there in a majority position setting a different agenda. That's the difference. We would set a completely different agenda than what we have today.
Now, Mr. Baldwin, you have been going back and forth, at least the campaigns, about having a debate. You say the candidates are going to see each other a lot so the voters can compare. No. You have decided to go to a Farm Bureau Convention candidate forum. Mm-hmm. Is for you, it's candidate forums are better than debates? Is that the final word?
Well, it's not choir practice. I mean, he can say what he thinks and I can say what I think. I'll say you support Obamacare. I voted against it 23 times. You've got an A rating. I've got an A rating from the NRA. You've got an F. I'm endorsed by Right to Life. You're pro-choice. You're endorsed by the AFL-CIO. I'm trying to defend the right to work law. So it's one chance for people to see the differences.
Senator Lamar Alexander is our guest on Inside Politics. He's up for re-election in November. Back to continue our conversation with him after you watch these messages. Stay with us.